Good morning, everyone. Hi, welcome to the Lightning Talks on day two, so the first session in this Congress. Who of you is the first time here in the Lightning Talks, in the audience at least? Well, that's quite a lot. And regarding the speakers, whose first time, whose first talk is this? Quite a lot. That's great because I have a short introduction presentation right now to tell you how this session works. So for all the speakers, please sit in the front rows. Get on the stage quickly when your talk is coming up. I will announce every talk with a title and then simply deliver your talk. How to deliver your talk? First of all, most important, talk into the microphone. Don't go away from the microphone. So as soon as your hands leave the podium, you can no longer hear me. Don't turn around to look at your slides up there, because most of the time you can't hear what is being said. You have a monitor down here where you can see the slides, and no need to turn around. Then use the clicker to advance the slides. The clicker is here, find it here, and leave it here after you are ready. And stay calm, talk loud and clearly. Finish on time, which is very important. Get your applause and leave the stage. Yeah. Thank you. I'm not going to leave the stage right now because I still have the something to tell for the audience. How to listen to Lightning Talks? Well, it's pretty simple. Be excellent to each other and watch the timekeeper. The timekeeper is this device here, which was created by Big Alex over there, who's operating it right now. And he will briefly explain how this thing works.
Yeah, most of you should know, hello, welcome everybody at first. Most of you should know how the timekeeper works by now. It signals you the remaining time for your talk. You have 5 minutes, as long as it's green, you're in the first 4 minutes of your talk, and then it goes up like this. And if it's in this position, you still have about 1 minute left, and the next 30 seconds will be yellow, and the last 30 seconds will be somewhere in this red area. And when it's about this, I need your support. I think you know how this works. It's 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. I think this worked well. Do we need to try it again?
Yeah, just no? One more time, for old time's sake. Okay, let's try it again.
Yeah,
okay. Oh, okay.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Okay.
Everyone is awake now, I think.
Fair enough. All right, anything else? There are translations available. See c3lingo.org for information on how to listen to the translations. And then, well, let's have a great session. So, first up is Mailman. Let me just start it.
There
you go.
So, welcome to the first Lightning Talk on one of the last Congresses without surveillance. This talk will be about a door opening system. So, at my apartment, I have one of those systems where I can see someone who rings the doorbell in a video camera system. And I wanted to grab that video because, well, you never know, maybe the mailman rings. Of course, well, this never happens. Maybe burglars ring the doorbell while I'm not at home, or unicorns, that's probably the most likely event. So I tried this at home. What I have at home is an Elcom system. They are very popular, and they are advertised to be very secure and safe. My solution was just buying another adapter from Elcom, and then another USB video adapter, and then I can run this on Linux and grab the video. Pretty easy, pretty cheap. And then I have some solution with FFmpeg mancoder just to check if the video is there, if it's just a gray image. And some more magic going on to send a notification to my smartphone, and also to get the last image so that I see who was ringing the doorbell. That worked well, and 5 minutes after installing, I get the first notification saying, someone rang your doorbell. I was like, ooh, did I script something wrong? Checked all the scripts. No. Checked the last image. There is an image. It's a person I don't know. What is going on? Well, what is going on? I see my videos, but I also see the videos of all neighbors, and we are 19 parties living there. So it works well, but not as I wanted to use it. And then I asked the support, of course, like, did I do something wrong? Is this how it should be? Do I need to couple it to my doorbell signal to just grab my video, or how does it work? And I said, yeah, that's how it works. It's a feature. So the legal implications are a bit funny, so to say, because I just saw that the videos, they always last 3.5 minutes. So even if I hang up the doorbell, then I will always still get a long video. So even if you don't see the video, it's still recorded or at least streamed and can be recorded. What I didn't try so far is faking a signal of ringing a doorbell. So if I would ring a door that doesn't exist, for example, I might be able to just ring without really ringing somewhere and then recording forever, and then it would really be a surveillance camera. And in German law, it's a bit different. So the current legal implication would be it should just be 1 minute and so on, and people should be aware if they are recorded. So it's really strange. This should not be happening, and you should really consider that these cameras are surveillance cameras, even if they are not supposed to be. If you like this talk and want to see more about security, I also have a talk on day 4 about Bluetooth firmware security. And do you have any questions about this talk here? Okay, then one brief question to you. Who of you has a door opening system with a camera at home? Yes, yes, yes. Oh, yeah, that's really a few. That's great. Yeah. Then, who is the next speaker?
Thank you. Next up is Kidspace.
Can you press F? Can you press F?
Yeah, there you go.
So my name is Casper, and I'm presenting Kidspace.org. It's a website to share electronics projects. So the way electronics are assembled, the way electronics are put together is you have a printed circuit board and you have components that you solder onto the printed circuit board. You have through-hole components where the legs of the components go through the printed circuit board and you solder one side of them. You have surface mount components where they sit on top of the printed circuit board and you solder them onto the board with careful application of heat. You can do this by hand, like in this little video, or you can, if you have a lot of components and tiny pitch components, you probably want to have some sort of reflow process and use a solder paste. You can do this with a hacked toaster oven, and it really saves a lot of time and effort to do it that way. If you want to know more about how to do that, just check out your local hackerspace. Check out, obviously, loads of workshops here at 35C3. If that interests you, you should do that. The way printed circuit boards are designed is you normally have a schematic layout tool and a schematic entry tool and a PCB layout tool. So you enter the you kind of define all the connections that you want to make on one side, and then you go into your layout tool and then kind of connect them up on a physical model of your board. So people do this, and they share them online freely. So there's more and more electronics projects that you can make use of that people are putting up. I kind of do this informal survey normally every year when I give some talks at FOSDEM or at other conferences. I don't know what happened to the GitHub numbers there. They seem to go down. I don't know if that has anything to do with the Microsoft acquisition, but I think it's more likely that they changed the way they index their boards. But on the whole, obviously, it's cumulative. There's more and more electronics projects up online that you can make use of, and there's obviously loads of different ways that people share these projects. The problem with it is that everyone has their kind of own way of designing things, putting things together, putting it up on their blog, putting it on GitHub, all these different ways of doing things, and it's often kind of hard to see to get to the point where the designer was and replicate the project that they created. And the solution that I'm it's largely me, it's an open source project, but it's largely me, and the idea is to take all these different ways of doing things and sort of introduce a minimal standard so that we can get what we want, which is obviously the printed circuit board and the parts, so that we can also replicate this project. So the way I'm going about this is kind of in two parts. There's the one-click bill of materials browser extension and the kitspace.org project sharing website. So the browser extension, it automates purchasing by replicating the web requests that are sent when you use retailer sites. There's a little video of it here. Maybe, I don't know, I seem to be running out of time. But it adds things to retailer shopping carts by replicating these requests. You have different ways of adding your bill of materials to it. So the other part of it is kitspace.org, which is a project sharing website where we can combine the printed circuit board with the bill of materials together with some information and a README and an easy way to buy the printed circuit board and an easy way to buy the parts that you need to do it. So the idea of it really is this virtual kit that the designer doesn't have to bag components and put everything together and send it to you, but you can yourself have the agency to buy everything you need to replicate a project. I'm working on tools to make it easier to document projects and put the bills and materials together, because that's really a challenge to get designers to put that effort in to make it documented in a way that's replicatable. So I have a bill of materials tool that I'm working on. It's kind of still in development, but it's usable, has some edge cases. There's a lot of libraries that go into making this a nice user experience for
Five,
people.
5, 4, 3, 2,
any questions? Find me at Open Science Hardware Assembly.
Thank you. All right, then next up is Hacking Climate Change. Don't hurry, I still have to work out this complicated slide change. Jesus. Okay, there you go.
1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Hi. Very recently, I've been part of the hackathon called Hack for Climate. Last year, we were in Bonn at the United Nations Climate Change Conference, and we were running a hackathon on a boat. This is our boat, 100 people from all over the planet, and it was a very empowering experience because I could understand how this politics works. Like, we are hackers, makers, duocracy. We are using our tools. And these guys, they are mostly talking. And that was, I just realized, ooh-la-la, there is zero. There is absolutely zero chance for these guys to reach an agreement across 190, 200 countries, different political fractions. It is just not going to happen. This is me at this large room. This is a young girl from Sweden who organized the protest. Her speech is very emotional. It has only 3 minutes long. I encourage you to watch this girl speak, because she is really, really special. These are just some few pointers for you, that ExxonMobil was founding climate change studies, but they were denying it. This is some article from more than 100 years ago that scientists were aware of climate change. This is the Lake Chad in Africa that is drastically reducing the surface area. This is the Aral Sea, and one of these islands, this was the biological weapons, you know, playground. And now you can just go there by land. And if you happen to be in Kazakhstan, this is the only nuclear weapons testing site. So just a little tangent. Anyway, I just want to tell you that the climate change is for real. There are multiple feedback loops and tipping points that this is a very unstable and fragile organism. And there are different, I would say, civil disobedience, non-violent direct action, Extinction Rebellion, which originated in the UK and it's now international movement. And also in France, we have the Yellow Vests movement, who are a little bit more violent. So I was just thinking, rather than trying to influence the government, rather than telling the government, hey, can you please do this, can you please do that, I was thinking about us becoming the government. Because that at Congress, we are able to organize 10, 12, 15,000 people. This building has a capacity to sustain a civilization. I can imagine the hydroponic vertical gardens in this glass building in the middle. We can have a one hall dedicated for, I don't know, sleep, rest, recovery. And I think that we should think about tools, how we can organize ourselves to be more active on the political scene. This is the session that I'm organizing in about 1 hour. It is not shutting down the internet, because shutting down the internet would be a very dangerous thing, but we are thinking how to make this protest in the online space. How can we send the message to the government to actually, hey guys, you need to get your act together, otherwise it will be us who will be in parliament, it will be us who will vote for our own president. So this is, you can take a QR code. This is, this room is far away, but if you want to contribute, you will always find the way. And this is the timer, okay. I've run very quickly through the slides, but basically what I want to say that these politicians, this United Nations, it's very difficult to reach a consensus because it is a consensus thing, and it is enough for one country to block any proposal, and then, there is no consensus. So when you have 200 countries with so many different political implications and so many different things, it is unlikely to happen. And yeah, I'm inviting you to join the session, planning how we can protest, how we can organize, what can we do to act together.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Thank you. Next up is Body-Mind Operating Systems.
Hello everyone, my name is Dimitri from Nodus Labs, and I want to talk about body-mind operating systems. We all know what operating systems are, we use them on a daily basis. However, what I want to propose today is to think of an operating system as a metaphor. So what kind of software, what kind of operating system we run as human beings. We have a lot of inspiration to choose from, starting from religions to different spiritual practices, ideologies, divinational systems, implicit value systems, organizational operating systems such as holocracy, political ones. Hip-hop can also be seen as an operating system in terms of an attitude that it proposes, scientific operating system. So we have a lot, and what I want to put out there is that I think just like it's important to look into the code of the software and hardware that we use, it's also important to look at the behavior of patterns that we have, at our habits, at what we learned through our culture, through education, and to question it, to find the code, to reverse engineer it, and to change it, to keep the stuff that we like, and to get rid of the stuff that we don't like. This is the first thing I want to put out there, to think of the software that we run as human beings. The second thing is a kind of use case, an operating system that we developed that's called 8OS, that I also propose you to try in the context of this Congress. It's happening today at 5 and tomorrow at 2. It's like a physical practice workshop, actually. One of the features that is very important about this operating system, 8OS, is that it's based on learning through the body, not only the mind, because a lot of times we learn about very abstract concepts through our mind, but as soon as we get them through our body, we get a really direct understanding of the patterns that we're working with, so that they get ingrained into us on the level of reflexes, and it becomes a much more efficient way of learning. It's also inspired by complex system science and also different body practices, so it has this theoretical aspect as well as the pragmatic and practical one. And another important feature is that it looks for universal applications in other contexts. So we practice through the body, but that is only to learn how we can apply the principles that we learn somewhere else, outside, maybe in work, in life, when we work on systems and so on. So for example, one of the things we work on here are some images from the practice sessions that we have. People apply 8OS in different contexts, starting from art to music to science to work and so on. I'm just going to explain some of the principles, maybe only one because there's not enough time to do all of them. One of the principles we work with is that of assimilative adaptivity. So normally when something happens in life, like a tension or some problem or conflict, we tend to respond to it with tension, and that leads to escalation. So the more tension we experience, the more tension we give back. And this leads to a very inefficient waste of energy. So what we propose is to think of it as something that you can assimilate and embrace into your system to understand it better through your body, and to then find a way to respond to it in a more interesting, in a more efficient way, working with the idea of confluence, flow, wave dynamics, and so on. I will just fast forward to the slide that has information about the sessions that are going to happen today at M3 at 5 o'clock and at 2. It's just over there on the left. I invite you to come and to try it out. We will work a lot with the concepts that are also used in hacking, such as resilience, adaptation, infiltration, but when we use them as words, they are very abstract. As soon as we try them out through the body, they become very concrete. So this is an interesting way to also break your day that you have here, where you work with your minds, and to get into your body and to try things out to see how it works. And just like with any software, you can install it in your system, try it out. If you like it, then you keep it. If you don't, then you don't. It's open source, so that means you can go back and reverse engineer it. So thank you very much. Come and join. You will be very welcome and you will enjoy it. Thanks.
Thank you. Okay, GPS power side channels is up next.
The cheapest power side channels, and this is some work we've been organizing with Alyssa Milburn. So, what are these side channels? Well, if you have a microprocessor, maybe it has a secret key inside, and you want the secret key. So you can send it some inputs, maybe you can see some outputs, but you can certainly monitor the power usage. And if you can do this, hopefully you can recover the key. So these side channels are great. You measure the power, and you get cryptographic keys. But we are cheap and lazy. We don't want to buy an oscilloscope, and all this analog stuff is complicated, and it's a lot of maths. We just want the keys. So these oscilloscopes are expensive, and people have tried to make them cheaper. But at the end of the day, this is still a lot of beer. Therefore, we've built the Horoscope. It's approximately €5. It's basically an XMega 32 breakout board, and this XMega has a 12-bit ADC, which works at 2 mega samples per second. Also, it does glitching. So we have an oscilloscope, but now we need a target. So we've decided to use the Arduino Nano. It's cheap and familiar. Everyone knows it, and it's totally not secure. And we've also downloaded some AESs from the internet to use as targets. OK, so what do we have? We have our target. We have an oscilloscope. What's left? Some challenges. So it turns out we're actually sampling well below the Nyquist frequency. The Arduino runs at 16 megahertz. We're sampling at 2. And people have told us this doesn't work. Also, we don't have an analog front end. We don't have an amplifier. And we're not going to bother. Also, you know, we have these other sources of noise and problems. So, you know, noise. So even if we have all this noise, and I had all this noise because I didn't configure the ADC properly, you know, that's not too much of a problem. You just take 100 of these measurements, you average them, and you get, you know, and suddenly an AES appears. What will be even better is if you don't misconfigure the ADC, like we did here. And as you can see, we can actually have a very nice power trace. And we can actually also we also have a nice GUI, so we can pretend we have a real oscilloscope. And then the next step will be actually recovering the key. And this would be a call to join us for a workshop, but sadly, they're all full. So please talk to us maybe in the break, maybe afterwards, maybe talk to Alyssa on Twitter. And that's it.
All right, thank you. Well, so next up is we need to do better than Cyberpunk, I think, because I just closed my window where I have all the slides. I'm opening it right now. And here we go.
So hello, my name is ALXD, and I wanted to talk about stories, and especially about hacker stories, because for the last 2 years I've been researching hacker values in popular culture and the types of stories we tell. Because as hackers, we have a lot to say. We have a lot of proposals on how technology should work in the society, how we want to avoid all the dangers we can see that others cannot see. But we do a very, very bad job at communicating it. Whenever we try to talk about net neutrality, about free software, people see us like black hats, like conflict mongers that are there to only smash the system, to destroy their bank accounts, and to basically bring trouble. And the problem is that we need to tell stories, not only produce white papers, because most of the general public will not read the white papers. They want to hear stories, and they need to have in mind that there may be problems if somebody uses only closed solutions. There may be problems if somebody basically buys only closed corporate stacks and is totally dependent on closed social media. The cyberpunk genre started as a warning, but sadly, it became our default future. And if you talk to a lot of non-technical people, you can see that they see cyberpunk as basically the future. If they see some new piece of technology, they don't say, oh, it's so futuristic. They say, oh, it's so cyberpunk. And especially outside of Europe, outside of the US, you can see a lot of makers, a lot of people that are actually wishing for a cyberpunk future because they wish for better technology, for better integration of technology with our bodies, completely ignoring the fact that cyberpunk actually proposes a lot more, that cyberpunk introduces the constant surveillance, the mega corporations, and total lack of power to among the regular people, and this all comes in a bundle. So wherever people dream of cyberpunk future, we actually normalize those things. And it's much easier to accept surveillance. It's much easier not to rebel against corporations, against a lot of solutions that are bad for society if we see it constantly. The stories that we tell as hackers are usually stories of rebellion against that. And hackers are, again, seen as some exceptional individuals that are fighting the system, and is always fighting the system. There are very, very, very few works that actually tell about our values, about free software, about technological neutrality, that are accessible to regular people, that can talk about the whole society. And sadly, with those, we only strengthen dystopias, because we agree to actually be written in the cyberpunk narrative as those fighters that are the element of the cyberpunk. And also we alienate ourselves farther from the society, and people in governments, people in different councils are much less likely to talk to us when it comes to giving any advice, because we are the conflict mongers. There is an alternative, that's a chance that we can take. There is a new genre which is being created right now. The name is solarpunk, and it's supposed to be an alternative to the cyberpunk future. Solarpunk is a utopia, or at least a hopeful future. It's a future that is available for everybody, not for only exceptional individuals, which is very green and eco-friendly, where everything is designed to be as green as possible, where there are horizontal power structures. So the things that we know from our hacker spaces, the things that we know from the anarchism that is all around us at CCC, they propose it for the whole society, so that every school teacher, every baker, every average regular person is able to take part in that. And this is a great platform for us to tell the actual hacker stories, to tell about our adventures, our problems that we have as society within our groups, and platform to tell about distributed technology and open source and free software. So I want to tell about hacker spaces in this way. This is an art that was created by Mike Luzzi, and please contact me on my email or Mastodon if you would like to discuss this topic. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. The next talk you're going to listen is Event Fahrplan by TBSR PRS.
Here he comes. And here are the slides.
Hello, everyone. Nice to see you. Thank you for coming. Quick show of hands. Who does not use a smartphone? What I really want to ask is, like, who knows somebody who doesn't use a smartphone? Yeah. OK. That's a lot. Sorry for you. This is about smartphones. And actually, it's about Android smartphones. I hope those iPhone users still stay around. Most of the talk also applies for iPhones, although this is about the event schedule. So my name is Tobias, and I'm maintaining this app for a while. And I want to tell you about it. I hope it's not too boring, because most of you maybe know the app, but I start with the basics because there are newcomers here. So it looks like this. What actually brought me to this app is actually this grid view, where you can compare things on the same level. You see what happens at the same time. I hope you also rotate your phone, because the same is possible on the phone if you don't use a tablet. And that's like the selling feature for me, but there's of course more. The basic stuff is you can select your favorites, watch them, delete them. You can export them. I don't know if many people found that because the app does not use any tracking, so I'm totally blind of what you do or what you don't. There's this share button to export favorites. And you can kind of change the style how the favorites are visualized in the grid view. Alarms, you can set up alarms for talks, so you're reminded upfront. So you can go to a talk that is like far away on the other side of the Congress building and inspect the list of alarms and also customize things about the alarms, so the default timing and like the tone. There's schedule updates, which are pretty recent here on Congress because there are so many stages and everyone changes things now and then, and so you get a lot of notifications that you can mute if you want. So you can disable the updates in total and just press the refresh button, or you can go into the Android settings and mute the channel for those updates. That's something you can do. There's more things, so you can put the events into your personal calendar on the phone, share them on Twitter or whatever. You can vote, and I encourage to do that. Like, all the talks have a voting backend, which I redirect to, and then you can give feedback to the speakers. There's like stars, but you can also write a text. And that's very valuable, so people know how they performed. Last but not least, there's an integration with the navigation app, the C3 NAV project, a very good project to get you around the building. There's an extra app you have to install, otherwise it redirects you to the website. Short introduction to the backend. What basically happens in the background is that there's a lot of stages like this, and they all have their own system to organize talks. They're running pre-talks, and there's this big system which has been used for years called FRAP, and that's for the main five stages. And the VOC team collects all the data and aggregates it into one file. And what the schedule app basically does is just fetching an XML file. And that comes with advantages and disadvantages because there's different systems and different formats, timestamps, time zones. Things can happen, things can go wrong, but by now it looks quite stable. This talk is titled One App to Serve You All. And what happens here is Congress gives you this app, and but there's more. During the year, I deploy this app for other conferences, CCC conferences, and even more. And so the last year was a lot of work. There were a couple of conferences where this app came into play and where was used by several users. And as you can see, there's a lot. Actually, it was 14 apps, and I had 56 releases over the time. And then back in 2017, as the same thing happened. And it all started with Tux Mobile, who actually created this project. I joined the project like 5 years ago. And it's open source. And the problem is there's many people using, but there's just one developer. And I'm very thankful for all the feedback and for the bugs, but this is a call for participation. And there's many things you can do. And there's a lot of things, even if you're not programming, that you can help with. And I encourage you to reach out and help with the project, because this is totally wrong at the moment. One developer won't survive.
All right, thank you. Now, next up, Alex, do we know what's up next? I think it's...
Oh, the next talk was how to code with DIP switches by Swally.
Yeah, so this one is in the browser as well. F. There you go.
Hi, I'm Swally and I code demos. My project started with a question, what's the minimum size of a demo you can do on Atari 2600? I came up to the conclusion that it was something like 32 bytes, because I needed some routines, some basic routines to get things done. But to me, there was something missing to show how minimal and hardcore this is. Something that shows a real programmer, as defined by XKCD. The discussion about this is, what is the real hardcore user interface you use can use to code? Well, I don't even need that needle. I just use DIP switches to come up with something that looks like this. So what I've got there is a board that kind of has a 5-bit address decoder that selects one out of these 32 DIP switches, 8-bit. These 8-bit data are written on the data bus if the ship select signal has been enabled. Diodes make sure that there's no short circuit. This also means that no cheating is possible, because there are no programmable components used. It also means that I've been using much less space than the address space is. The 32 bytes I'm going to use are mirrored 128 times, and this will become very handy later on. The demo I coded is used for NTSC because in this context it's much easier for me to code 262 video lines of NTSC than 312 for PAL. This is what the opcodes that the CPU knows, and these are the only ones that are really useful in a 32-byte demo. So I need give a bit of a background. When the CPU starts, there are two special memory addresses that are used. There are two others that are used as an interrupt vector. So when the system is initialized, I have to do it myself. So I need to write something like the first 43 bytes of data, zero them out myself. Now let's take a look on how that can be achieved. This is a very minimum reset routine. I'm using an undocumented opcode to set two registers at once. Then I'm going to write in a loop the zero that I've got there 256 times, because it doesn't matter if I write more than the 43 bytes. But this can be optimized. I can go more minimum. So the trick there is that I'm not caring what inside my accumulator is. I'm just shifting it out and writing it backwards by pushing it on the stack. The stack is also mirrored by hardware at the same address than the I/O and RAM area. And I'm just checking there if I have cleared out all the stack in this loop. This also comes in very handy because this code can be entered at all the first three opcodes. It doesn't matter which one I use. So now, remember the mirroring. Remember that the routine can be entered in different points. Now I'm going to want to use the interrupt vectors and the reset vector for using with code. Since the ROM is mapped in as F000 to FFFF, the high byte should be an FX. And now I'm going to show you what I did. This is what the code looks like. And I'm now searching for an F something in there. I found one there. And I try to use this one as my reset vector. So I'm going to move it around the code at this address. Now the red line is used as the not only as data for the reset vector, but also as the code that you see in there. And this reset vector now points to the green line. So this is where the reset starts. And as I told, the reset routine can be entered at any of these three addresses. So this reset routine will still clear out and do what I intended it to do. And the code on the bottom wraps around to the next mirror window that I've got in there. So everything is working just fine by rotating the code. This is what this demo looks like when it's running. And this is what it looks like when I change just one bit of code. So, and if you want to know about more of this in detail, you can meet me at the retro area in Hall 2. There also is, you can see it online at the website implemented. And since I've got a short time, I won with this one a first prize at a demo competition. And the most response I've got in there is, this is great, but you're nuts. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, I want to close all my tabs. All right, then next up is make automotive great again. All right.
So, it works. Hello, can you hear me?
No, you have to stay closer to the mic.
More close. Hello.
You can also adjust it if you...
If you take your hands from the lecture thingy, the microphone stops to work.
Okay. Let's try this. So, hello. I'm talking about automotive-grade software. Who here in this hall is using a car or interacting with cars in any way? So some people are still awake. So I've got bad news for you, unfortunately. So the bad news is there's lots of computers in cars nowadays. So probably you know this already. I've put some asterisks in there where computers are stored normally. Most of these computers actually are of no big concern. So there are small computers. They basically help you with driving. They are safety related, so they can kill you, probably. But they're done by cool people that know what they're doing. And they're really small, and so the complexity is manageable. Yeah, so you really know how these interact. And then there's one other big computer, that's the infotainment system. And nobody cares about the infotainment system because that's just some kind of mobile phone that you use for showing navigation, and you can firewall it off. Yeah, and the problem now is that in the automotive industry, there's hypes, and the current hype is autonomous driving. And if we draw network pictures for all these computers and cars, we see that somehow blue boxes pop up nowadays. And if we look at them more closely, these blue boxes are some kind of central computing clusters that are connected to everything inside the car. Because what they need to do is they need to get data from every sensor in that car, they need to do some kind of sensor fusion, and they need to do driving decisions, so they need to steer the brakes. And it's not only from inside the car, it's also from the outside. So you can see that there's a connection from that cloud giving data to that central computing cluster that then uses this data to steer your braking in the car. And this is fine. So what we did was we now connected all these nice little stars in my Mini to the Internet of Hate. And this is a bit complicated because that's something new for the automotive industry. So we now have highly complex systems, high performance processors that need safety and security. We don't know what security is. We don't know how safety works in these kinds of systems. What we do know is we need to go there fast because Tesla and Google and Uber already do something like this, so every car maker wants to have their own solution for that. And what do you do as a company if you don't know how to go there? So basically, what you do is you ask around and then you buy knowledge. Yeah. So every major car maker nowadays bought a hypervisor startup, a cloud startup, a blockchain startup, a machine learning startup, and two or three cyber startups, because you can't have enough cyber in your systems. And the problem now is they still don't understand. Yeah, and there are big corporations that did things for decades, and they really need to understand security. That's obvious. I won't talk about security much longer. They also need to understand open source, because that industry is an industry fueled by NDAs, fueled by not invented here. So they are really trying to keep things secret. And we need to make them aware that on some parts of the systems, especially when it comes to safety and security, it might be a good idea to actually collaborate and do things in the open. And how do you do that in a big organization? So consulting doesn't work. what I really want to achieve is that the cars stay as nice as my Mini. So we won't have any Skynet and we won't have any big hacking going on in cars. And my proposal is to change the automotive industry from the inside. So what I actually want is I want you to join the automotive industry and to try to teach them how to build secure systems. And they're actually looking for you, and they know that they need that knowledge and that they need to build up that knowledge. But it's really tricky getting there because they are discouraging. Yeah, they are big corporations and they are slow and they don't know how software works. So really, we need to break that loop, get in there, change them. That's it.
Right. Thank you. Next up is Strokes, helping you learn Chinese characters. Just a moment, please. There you go.
Hello, can you hear me? All right.
Yeah, a bit closer, I think.
All right. So here's a too long didn't watch version of this presentation. So I started learning Chinese, and I found that basically learning how to write Chinese characters is pretty difficult. And I found an Android app. It's definitely super cool, but I decided to write something else based on it, and I'm gonna show it and invite you to collaborate. Actually, that was meant to be an animation. Okay, so I started learning Chinese about a year ago, and I found this application called Inkstone, which I definitely recommend. It's an Android application that's meant to teach you how to write characters. You basically learn stroke by stroke how to write the characters that you choose. And the thing that I didn't like about it was that it's not really in paper, so you don't really get the feedback if you get anything wrong. And because of that, I decided to write something else, something of my own. So here's a quick fact about the Chinese characters. So basically, they are made of strokes, which is basically like a couple of lines. And the characters are mostly made of sub-characters. And the stroke order is important. So it's very important to learn how to actually write the characters, like in the correct order. And the regular Chinese way of learning that, the one that I heard about, is to just repeat 1,000 times each character, and you're going to learn how to write it. I don't really think this is the right way, so I'm basically looking for something else, some other way to get there. So the Inkstone, the application that I found, the Android one, was built on something called Make Me a Hanzi, which is basically a database of SVG graphics describing each of the characters, split stroke by stroke. And given this database, I decided to write an application that basically gives this kind of output. So here we are learning four characters. And you can see that there is this, it's split into groups. And for each of the characters, there is like four groups of four tiles. Stroke by stroke, you are learning first the new stroke, then all strokes so far, then all the strokes in context, and then you are supposed to learn the geometry by putting it with no aids, with no help. And then once you learn the characters, you are expected to recall them from memory, which is what the empty tiles are meant for. And in the current form, it's hosted on strokes.ovh, but I would expect it to go down in a couple of minutes, given the volume of the amount of people here. So basically, here are a couple of links explaining the logic, the reasoning that I, basically my reasoning behind the application, how I chose the design and so far. And given that I expect the server to go down, here's the way to actually run it locally. And here are the ways you could help me. So first of all, I made a list of GitHub issues. You could basically just take a look at this and see if there's anything you could help me with. Most preferably, it would be best if I could find somebody that is like fluent with Flask, some way to actually make the user experience more reasonable than it is right now, because I can see many modes of learning, but it's not really, the application isn't there yet in this particular regard. I could definitely use some feedback. So if you know some kind of Chinese teacher that would basically that is willing to try it out in a classroom, that would be great if I could find out if it's already working for them or if there's something I could change. And I guess that's it. So my name is Dita, and my email is basically my username at gmail.com. And at the top right piece of the screen, you can see the link to the presentation. Thank you.
Thank you. Next up is Dissolving Gafam, a bit at a time.
I'm too tiny for this preview screen. Hello, Congress. Wash your hands. And who knows what GAFAM is? That's an abbreviation meaning Google, Android, Facebook, Amazon, and Microsoft. So these are the IT multis. This talk is a little bit a sequel or continued talk to what I said last year about self-hosted microblogging. So Dissolving GAFAM, a bit at a time. Tim Berners-Lee keeps saying we need to decentralize the internet. He's saying this for years now. How's the clicker? And what is the current situation? We have very few really large, huge monopolies dominating the internet. And at the same time, the complexity and the bloat around us is also growing. Most people on the internet are rather clueless about what they are doing. And there are very few decision makers and very many people affected by those decisions, which have close to no voice. So what are the problems that come from that? Or what's the problem about this situation? Those huge corporations are very unlike you all. So their goals are very unlike your goals. And by participating and using their services, you are taking part in a huge behavioral study, and you're a monitored dependent supplicant, like a testing person. The services are volatile, and you have no demanding right. You cannot demand the responsibility or the existence of the service tomorrow or the week after tomorrow. There's been numerous services being shut down always, almost overnight. And that's not a nice situation to live in. And minorities are marginalized and near to invisible because to these huge organizations, those minorities, there's just too many of them. So Conway's law says a system resembles and mirrors the organization that builds it. So what would you expect? What systems would you expect from those huge organizations? On top comes that technologists are proud in finding technological solutions to problems. That's not necessarily the easy or the simple ones. That's the complex, and those solutions the experts can be proud of. This is probably not what we need. What we need is reliable services for one's own. So I think a response to those huge companies and their huge services is to self-host, to do it yourself, to use materials from other small entities, and keep away from the big brands. The IndieWeb with their posse idea, post on your own server, syndicate elsewhere, is a good idea to feed the big services and still be the one in the driver's seat by publishing on your own server first. Then it is very important to learn about the mechanics of these services, of the internals, not in depth of detail maybe, and to tell others about it, to spread the word. So I want you to reconsider using those great services less and have a look into how could you use small services and promote them. Thank you.
Thank you. Next up is a German talk. Open source im ERV am Beispiel von Jay Lawyer. After this talk, we are going to have a 15-minute break until 12:50. So if you want to change rooms because you want to see another talk or something, then you can do it after this talk. And we just go ahead right now.
Hallo zusammen, mein Name ist Christoph Müller. Ich bin Rechtsanwalt und Anwender...
Bisschen näher ans Mikrofon, man hört dich gar nicht.
So. Hallo zusammen, mein Name ist Christoph Müller. Ich bin Rechtsanwalt und Anwender von jlawyer.org. Ich habe meine komplette Kanzlei auf Linux laufen, was ein bisschen aufwendig ist und vor allem eigentlich in dem System, in dem ich mich als Anwalt bewege, nicht so richtig reinpasst. Ich muss mich zukünftig und auch schon jetzt mit dem elektronischen Rechtsverkehr, dem sogenannten ERV, auseinandersetzen. Das heißt, die Justiz benutzt bestimmte Protokolle, um miteinander zu kommunizieren, insbesondere Gerichte untereinander, aber auch andere Teilnehmer am elektronischen Rechtsverkehr sind vorhanden. Für mich als Rechtsanwalt ist es auf jeden Fall wichtig, dass ich eine Verbindung zu den Gerichten habe, aber ich habe auch andere Teilnehmer, die gegnerischen Rechtsanwälte natürlich, die Notare oder Behörden, und wenn es gut läuft, kann ich auch noch meinen Mandanten damit reinbringen. Was mich dazu bringt, dass ich diese Punkte alle irgendwie unter einen Hut bringen kann. Ein Großteil meiner Kollegen, wie auch ich, benutzt dafür eine entsprechende Software, eine Kanzleisoftware. Das ist allerdings ein Problem, nämlich dahingehend, dass diese Kanzleisoftwaren, die existieren, vornehmlich proprietär sind. Wir haben also Abhängigkeiten von unseren Anbietern. Wir haben das Problem, dass ich Vorgaben habe von meinen Anbietern für meine Kanzleisoftwaren, wie ich arbeiten muss. Und ich habe natürlich auch das Problem, dass ich da nicht wieder rauskomme, weil ich im Zweifel mein ganzes System darauf abgestellt habe. Und wenn da der Support endet oder sich in eine falsche Richtung entwickelt, komme ich nicht mehr weiter. Wie überall in der digitalen Welt könnte Open Source hier eine Möglichkeit bieten, diese Probleme jedenfalls ansatzweise zu lösen. Vorteile sind auf jeden Fall, dass ich mit offenen Formaten eine Langzeitarchivierung habe. Das heißt, ich dann auch nicht das Problem habe, dass ich von bestimmten Programmen oder Dokumenten abhängig gemacht werde und damit eventuell gar nicht sicher meiner Archivierung nachkommen kann, die ich brauche. Der Vorteil ist auch, dass ich natürlich bestimmte Sachen anpassen kann und den eigenen Bedürfnissen Rechnung tragen kann. Dazu kommt, dass wenn man sich engagiert, man natürlich auch sehr gut die Weiterentwicklung steuern kann und eben nicht abhängig ist von den Vorstellungen und Ideen der Softwareanbieter, die häufig ihre Großkunden haben und deren Gedanken oder deren Organisationsplänen nachkommen. Für mich ist natürlich Open Source auch deshalb interessant, weil ich als Linux-Nutzer sehr gerne auch ein Programm hätte, was bei mir läuft, ohne noch eine virtuelle Windows-Maschine laufen zu lassen, weshalb ich mich dann am Schluss auch für den JLawyer entschieden habe. Eine Adress- und Aktenverwaltung ist bei dem selbstverständlich. Das RVG, das Rechtsanwaltsvergütungsgesetz, ist gerade implementiert worden. Zukünftig geht es darum, auch weitere Sachen in der Finanzverwaltung, insbesondere Buchhaltung, Aktenkonto etc. zu haben. Und dann gibt es noch das allergrößte Problem, das allseits bekannte BEA. Das ist hier auf dem Kongress ja spätestens seit letztem Jahr schon mal in aller Munde gewesen. Dort ist es so, dass die Anpassung die Implementierung für das erste Quartal 2019 geplant ist. Allerdings ist das BEA selbst hochgradig proprietär und die Zusammenarbeit mit den Anbietern, also insbesondere der Bundesrechtsanwaltskammer, die das bereitstellt, und den dortigen Serviceanbietern ist nicht das Einfachste, sodass das eine große Herausforderung ist, insbesondere für ein so noch relativ kleines Projekt wie den JLawyer. Wo soll die Reise hingehen? Wir möchten natürlich weiterhin fördern, dass Open Source in der Anwaltskanzlei möglich ist. Dazu gehören nicht nur ich, sondern auch viele andere Kollegen, die dort bereits progressiv sind und versuchen, das Ganze voranzubringen. Selbstverständlich haben wir allerdings das Problem, dass wir Vorgaben haben gesetzlicher Art, nämlich bestimmte Sachen wie das BEA zu nutzen, sodass wir uns dort anpassen müssen. Ein großer Vorteil ist es allerdings weiterhin, dass wir selbst unsere Entwicklung vorantreiben können. Deswegen fordere ich oder würde ich mich sehr freuen, wenn alle Anwaltskollegen, aber auch alle Softwareentwickler uns bei dieser Sache unterstützen würden und den J-Lawyer zu einer guten Alternative zu den proprietären Modellen zu bringen. Vielen Dank.
Danke. All right, then we are going to take a 15-minute break now. I don't know, grab a beverage, take a walk, take the trash out, do whatever you like, but be here in 15 minutes at 12:50, where we continue with the next half of the session. All right, we are going to continue now with the second part of the Lightning Talk session. The next talk is going to be gender and IoT. One announcement I was told I have to make is that please don't sit on the tables you find here. We have lots of chairs. Don't sit on any tables.
Those tables are very dedicated creatures.
All right, then let's continue with the talks. Gender and IoT. Can you put up the slides? Video team, can you put up the slides from the presentation notebook? There you go. Thanks.
Okay, thank you very much, and good afternoon. My name is Leonie Tanzer. I'm a lecturer in International Security and Emerging Technologies from UCL, and I'm also principal investigator of a research project called Gender and IoT, which I'd like to present to you today and kind of use this as an opportunity for a call for action. Now, the title of the talk and also our research project already encompasses the buzzword IoT, and I'm sure some of you probably roll their eyes and think, oh my God, what is she talking about? Well, ultimately, the IoT is here, and it's an umbrella term comprising a lot of different systems, from tiny sensors to like gadgets that you might have found on your Christmas tree or already have hacked, to like larger cyber-physical systems such as connected autonomous vehicle. And what really is important for them is that they have smart capabilities, and that ultimately means the systems that we used to have like previously offline, we're connecting to a network. And while this is all you know, both scary and perhaps also daunting, these things are here to stay. And what we realize in our research group is that they are increasing over the next years, and we probably should think thoroughly about like what these systems are going to be doing, how they are designed, and how they are being used. So here just some stats. They are pure estimates. We have probably no clear vision of what the world will look like in 2030, but nevertheless, we do expect that they increase over the next year. Now, there's a lot of risk, uncertainties, and opportunities, but one thing that most people don't really look at, especially when it comes to research, but also industry actors, is the aspects of how these systems affect some of the most vulnerable groups in our society. The majority of research currently thinks more about the technical aspects around security, safety, or about the economic incentives that these systems provide, but less and less people focus on the aspects of how these systems can be abused. And that's actually a really fundamental question we should ask before we put those systems out into the wild. And to put that into context, technology facilitated abuse, and that ranges from cyberstalking, which was subject of certain talks over the last days, but also aspects such as online harassment are issues that we already face now, where we just have a lot of systems that are like tablets, laptops, and smartphones. So for example, here's a statistic from one organization in the UK called Refuge. Just from January to August 2018, so this year, there were 920 recorded survivors from technology-facilitated abuse. Now, this is a really big category that ranges from kind of online banking that was abused to text messages that people have received. But what our project really tries to do is move away from these kind of, and I'd say it in brackets, conventional cyber risks, to thinking more about like what the future will look like. And if you haven't had the chance to watch Demon Seeds, I highly recommend this film. It's from 1977, and it basically looks at aspects that we have to focus on with regards to IoT systems. Now, we are a project team of computer scientists and HCI research and social scientists, and we try to basically produce something called, which we like to say, action research. We don't just go off into the lab, test systems, and then come back and say, ta-da, that's the solution, but rather we work with stakeholder groups such as the London Violence Against Women and Girls Consortium, which are basically 29 refugees and women organizations in London, but also Privacy International and a research group called Petras. And our aim is basically to think about the role impact, but also the risk trajectories and the awareness that currently support services have when it comes to IoT. And I will tell you, like, there's little awareness on these issues as of now. And what we've done so far is we work with these communities that like provide support for victims and survivors. We run workshops, we do interviews, we even run a crypto party for the support services because we think that they need to have more capabilities to tackle these issues and know better how to deal with them. But also we currently are conducting a technical analysis of kind of common gadgets that people have in their smart home. And the insights that we have found so far are pretty daunting. And that's also why I'm standing here today, because the support services that basically are there to help victims and survivors are often really lacking awareness of what systems are being used and abused. And also the police is often pretty unaware of what IoT systems capabilities are. And so what we're doing currently is not just conducting research, trying to understand the phenomena, but also like providing services such as like information leaflets and others. So I think there's a lot of responsibility here that, and I hope that, for example, the hacker community would be interested in talking more about like with support services to deal with that emerging risk, including industry, politics and society. So I hope if you're interested in the topic, would like to learn more and perhaps get involved, I'd love to hear from you. That's it. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Next up is Chiptunes on ATtiny4.
Hi, I'm here to talk to you about my little side project. You can see the chip on a 1 cent coin below. It's Atmel's smallest microcontroller they offer, both in size and on program memory. It's 2.9 by 1.6 millimeters. Inspiration for this project came from this computer file video you might have seen of Rob Miles and of Dojo's noise plug, which uses the ATtiny9, which is one size up. Here you can see the development board I brought with me. The ATtiny4 has 512 bytes of ROM, 32 bytes of RAM, and 16 registers, and one timer. On the right, my setup. I'm using only open source software for this, so the GNU AVR toolchain and the USB AVR programmer. Since this is such a small microcontroller, I went to the route of hand transcribing Rob's original C program into assembler, and for this I something I call fake assembler, which is just a bunch of C macros that implements a subset of the assembler macros. And whenever I do a change, I run it through this little shell pipeline, which checks if the output is still the same and then automatically commits. There are about 150 commits that are all labeled new version. In the end, of course, removing those idiosyncrasies and implementing the initializing stuff, and that's about it. The ATtiny4, again, very small program memory. That was one of the objectives. Also, I wanted to run it at 4 megahertz so I can run down to 1.8 volts, which works perfect with a coin cell battery, and of course it should play a recognizable version of the tune. The first two were pretty easy. On the last one, I kind of ran out of debugging time, but you'll see that. Challenges were, of course, multiplication and division. It's pretty limited in space and time because of the 4 megahertz. So I went to the route of pretty much hard coding everything I can, and because I only needed very few parameters. Also, I never worked on the ATtiny4 before. It's very small again and doesn't have anything internal for debugging. Atmel provides a simulator, but that's proprietary and Windows only, so that was out of the question. And the open source simulators don't have support for this ATtiny10 core. So all I had was my oscilloscope and a lot of trial and error. Finally, I want to show you, listen to a few samples. Well, get in touch if you want to help me with debugging the final of the four voices. I'm also at the Hackaday assembly where you can have a closer look at the board. On the left, you see a QR code for this project. On the right, I've got a second project. Check it out if you want. Thanks.
Thank you. I'm terribly sorry, I just went ahead in time. Of course, the talk that was going to be was rabbit control. Are you here? Oh, I'm very sorry. All right, let's go then.
Hello, we are Jorek and Ingo. Our background is broadly speaking creative coding and setting up interactive installations where we often face situations like this. We are setting up an installation and then last minute need to control one of the parameters or a couple of the parameters of the installation, like say the brightness of an animation or something, or the volume of the sound. And we've done this a couple of times. Everyone probably has done this a couple of times. You have an application, you open up a UDP port or a WebSocket port, define a little protocol that, and then create a little UI interface, maybe web interface, and send values back to your application. And this is a very cumbersome thing that we've done a couple of times, so we wanted to optimize this situation. We've come up with Rabbit Control.
So Rabbit Control is a protocol which is made for UI control, as Jorek said already. One thing we really emphasize here is that you have like one client which can be used with many application, with your application. It can be written in different languages. And what it basically does, the client is asking for a list of exposed parameters, let's say the volume or the brightness. And then knows how to draw user interface elements for each of the parameters. And then you can send back control values to the host application and therefore control the application. This is a very small example how you would use the server. You instantiate a server. You use a WebSocket transport in this case. The protocol itself is transport agnostic, so you can use more than one transport to it. Then you expose, in this case, a float parameter and set it a value. And that is all you have to do.
So features of the protocol and APIs. It's an open protocol. We have defined many types with it. So you don't only have a control for a float, but you also can control colors and vectors and matrices. Most important for me is like we have one generic client possibly that connects to a myriad of any application that you define and expose parameters with. So we're solving this problem once and for all to control applications remotely. The protocol is transport agnostic. At the moment, we have WebSocket transport, but it's easy to add, say, serial transport or UDP or whatever one might need. What we have so far, the protocol is specified. It's a binary protocol. It's up for RFC on GitHub, we'll show later. We have many implementations already in different stages for these languages. And at the moment, we have two clients, as we said, this web client written in React TypeScript and a Xamarin Mobile cross-platform client we have in the works.
So it's an open source project, so it always needs people contributing. What we really would like to have at the moment is users, people who think it's useful for their projects, use it, give feedback, test it, therefore also, and give feedback, report. But also developers who can contribute to implement the protocol in different languages, tool makers or makers of frameworks to embed it in the framework, to just use it out of the box. And if you want to get in touch with the project, here you have the contacts for it, the GitHub page, code is there, it's open source, as said already. And if you want to meet us, we at 16 o'clock at 4 o'clock at CBase Assembly, we will be there. We will demo, we will answer questions if you're interested and want to know more about it.
Yeah, because obviously such a talk without a live demo is a bit stupid. Of such a system would be easily demoed live, so we'd be happy to show everyone anywhere. Contact us, and we are around for two more days, so we would be happy to show you how easy it is to use, and hopefully you will use it for your future projects. Thanks.
Thank you. So then next up is IP over Web Avian Carrier. All right, there you go. I'm sorry for the mix-up. After this talk, everything should be on track again.
Good morning. I'd like to talk, propose a protocol, IP over web Avian Carrier. And I use a lot of IP over Avian Carriers as specified in RFC 1149 and later extensions of the protocol. And how that works is that I have my IP datagram, I write it on a scroll of paper, put that on the leg of a homing pigeon. I own a couple of them and then send it away. And the homing pigeon finds the destination and then you can read the IP datagram again. Some limitations of the protocol, the MTU, the maximum transmission unit, depends on the carrier strength and the length of the leg of the pigeon. However, climate change changes our weather, and when the weather changes, homing pigeons get into trouble. And I had a lot of reliability issues lately. Storms and raptors are haunting my pigeons and thus harming my datagram transmission. In general, IP over Avian Carriers is not really up to the task for today's challenges. So we have limited bandwidth, we have high latency. So I was looking for a solution to that problem. And the solution is web Avian Carriers. And I figured out they are the perfect medium for IP datagram transmissions. So IP over web Avian Carrier is a link layer protocol that fits nicely into the stack. We don't have to change many things there. A little bit about the medium. It has medium properties that are advantageous to us, and there are some challenges in the medium. Let's talk first about the good parts. The medium has relaying. It's technically not necessary, but it adds a certain weight to certain IP datagrams, and it's basically that the link layer has a hive mind and can mark messages that are very important to more nodes in the network by relaying them. Some nodes in the network also strive for authentication, actively giving up their anonymity. And this is what we call node verification, and this is marked on the link layer with a blue check mark. There are some challenges to that medium. One very annoying is automatic error correction. Some nodes engage heavily in error correction activities. Error correcting datagram messages usually start with yes, but, or well, actually. And are often not very politely formulated. Error correction activity is believed to correlate with having little or no meaningful relationships with other humans. This applies to the humans running those error correcting nodes. In general, the link layer medium suffers from Godwin's laws that applies. Addressing on the medium is super easy. We just take the layer 3 addresses and convert them to so-called hashtags, dividing each octet by an underscore and adding the prefix length. The wire format is also very simple. It is not binary safe, that medium, so we have to base64 encode the IP datagrams and then add the address to the end via a hashtag. So does it really work? Yes, it does, better than my slides are scaling. This is the world's first IP over web Avian Carrier transmission, which took only something below 12 seconds, which is a huge improvement for me compared to my homing pigeons, which sometimes take weeks or days. Here is a PCAP of that transmission. You can see the echo request and the echo reply. You could descramble them if you like. The full specification and the reference implementation is available on my blog. There's also a video of the world's first IP over web Avian data transmission. Check it out. I think it's the link layer medium of the future. My name's Dan. Have a great Congress.
Thank you. Next up is Feminism Matters.
Da geht's weiter?
Ja.
Ja, moin. I'm sorry, this talk will be in German, but you can read everything in English. Jetzt geht's Deutsch weiter. Mein Name ist Lena Simon, ich bin Netzphilosophin und IT-Beraterin und engagiere mich bei den Hexen. Die werden euch gleich nochmal begegnen. Ich will einmal einen kleinen Moment über Feminismus reden mit euch. Und da will ich mit einem Lob einsteigen. In Relation zu den anderen, zu vielen anderen Veranstaltungen haben wir es hier auf dem Kongress eigentlich schon ziemlich gut. Also ärgert euch jetzt nicht, wenn ich Dinge sage, das betrifft nicht immer hier alle Anwesenden. Aber auch für uns hier ist es noch ein weiter Weg und ich dachte, lasst uns mal gemeinsam einen Schritt auf diesem Weg machen. So, wie geht's weiter? Hier geht's weiter. Wir haben in unseren Folien eine Menge Quellen verlinkt. Die Empfehlung ist, holt euch die einfach im Wiki und klickt die mal kräftig durch. Frauen können auch Mathe, sind aber irgendwie wesentlich weniger vertreten in den hochbezahlten mathematischen Informatik-Jobs. Sie verdienen weniger, eklatant, sind häufiger alleinerziehend, kümmern sich häufiger um Angehörige, Verletzte, pflegebedürftige Angehörige, haben insgesamt weniger Zeit und Geld dadurch. Und das sind beides Faktoren, die für demokratische Beteiligung relativ wichtig sind. Darin sehen wir ein gewisses Problem. Ein weiteres Problem, ach, ich sehe hier Folien, das ist ja super. Ein weiteres Problem ist, dass die Geschichten so aufgebaut sind, dass Frauen sie vielleicht hier die Folien nicht sehen können. Das ist jetzt ein wunderschönes Beispiel für Androzentrismus. Da wird nämlich der Mann zur Norm gemacht und die Frau ist halt die Abweichung. Das kann ganz fatale Folgen haben. In dem Moment, wo ich medizinische Erklärungen habe, die, ja, ein Herzinfarkt zum Beispiel, da wissen wir alle, wie das bei Männern aussieht. Bei Frauen äußert sich das anders und dadurch wird er auch wesentlich weniger schnell erkannt. Da kann das lebensgefährlich werden. Es geht aber auch an solchen Stellen bei uns in der Game-Szene zum Beispiel, dass einfach eine Menge verschiedene männliche Spielecharaktere vorhanden sind, die alle verschiedenen Charakter haben. Der eine spielt Fußball, der andere liest gerne. Und dann gibt es eben einen weiblichen Charakter und der zeichnet sich halt dadurch aus, dass er weiblich ist und, naja, vielleicht ein bisschen tussig oder so. Das ist blöd. Was wir auch leider hier auf dem Kongress durchaus vorkommen haben, sind irgendwelche doofen Fragen wie, wie bist du denn zur Technik gekommen? Ja, wie seid ihr es denn? Was sind das für eine Frage? Oder wenn mir jemand versuchen will, zu erklären, wie ich einen USB-Stick aushänge. Das sind so alles so Geschichten, Androzentrismus, schwierige Gelegenheit. Die Konsequenzen, Frauen sind schlecht präsentiert in den Parlamenten. In der Medizin sieht es ganz furchtbar aus. Guckt euch mal die Situation mit den Hebammen an. Menstruationsprodukte werden als Luxusprodukt besteuert. Die Pille wird übermäßig schlecht erklärt, was denn da eigentlich für Konsequenzen haben kann. Und apropos Tests, Medikamente werden häufig dann eben wieder nur an den Männern getestet. In der Care-Arbeit können wir es auch nicht richtig machen. Zu viel ist, führt natürlich dazu, dass die Jobchancen sinken. Zu wenig ist aber auch nicht gut. Dann sind wir irgendwie die faulen Rabenmutter oder so weiter. Wir haben Nachteile bei Einstellungen, sowohl auch, vielleicht habt ihr es mitgekriegt, wenn Code von Frauen, wenn da nicht dran steht, von wem, wie das Geschlecht der Person ist, die den geschrieben hat, wird der besser geratet. Wir sind Hass und Belästigung ausgesetzt an ganz vielen Stellen, wo wir zu unbequemen Themen den Mund aufmachen. Das ist nicht schön. Statistisch sollten wir uns vor allen Dingen vor unseren Partnern fürchten, denn in der Beziehung oder vom Ex-Partner droht uns eine Menge Gewalt. Wir werden auch aufgezogen mit der ständigen Befürchtung, dass sexuelle Belästigung irgendwie ein Thema sein könnte. Entsprechend passen wir auch unser Verhalten gerne mal an, setzen uns beispielsweise nur in bestimmte Wagen in der U-Bahn und das ist irgendwie unschön und schneidet die Freiheit ein. Wir haben hier ein paar Texte, wenn ihr weiterlesen wollt, die könnt ihr euch mal anschauen, die geben das ganz wunderschön zusammen. Und als nächstes, auch von den Hexen, sprechen Pico und Wiebke und erzählen euch, was wir Hexen uns überlegt haben, um an der Stelle ein paar Dinge zu ändern. Vielen Dank.
Danke. So, next up, die Hexen.
Also, this talk will be held in German, auch jetzt in Deutsch. Wir sind die Hexen Wir sind definiert als Hackerinnen, die sich selbst als weiblich labeln können, das heißt Cis-Frauen, Trans-Frauen und Non-Binaries, die das Label Frau für sich annehmen können. Wir sind ganz divers, ähnlich wie der CCC. Wir sind Studentinnen, wir sind Künstlerinnen, Programmiererinnen, ITler, aber auch ja, weitere Wissenschaften und auch Opernsängerinnen. Wir sehen uns als dezentralen Chaostreff, das heißt Teil des CCC, der größtenteils in Deutschland ansässig ist. Wir sind mehr als 150 Members. Wir treffen uns, also ungefähr 40 sind gerade auf dem 35C3. Wir treffen uns üblicherweise auf dem 35C3. Wir haben dieses Jahr eine sehr schöne Assembly in Halle 2. Kommt gerne vorbei. Wir haben in vielen deutschen Städten, jetzt in den letzten Jahren oft neu gegründet, lokale Gruppen, wo man einfach vorbeikommen kann. Und wir wurden 1988 gegründet. Das heißt, wir haben jetzt dieses Jahr unser 30-Jähriges.
Ja, was sind konkrete Probleme, die wir adressieren? Wir haben es gerade schon bei Lena gehört. Frauen werden immer wieder, denen wird immer wieder erzählt, oh, ihr könnt das nicht, pass auf, macht das lieber nicht. Technik, nee, lasst es mal lieber. Und dadurch entwickeln auch viele Frauen ein sogenanntes Imposter-Syndrom. Das heißt, sie trauen sich vielleicht bestimmte Sachen nicht zu oder sagen, oh, vielleicht findet irgendjemand mal raus, dass ich das eigentlich gar nicht kann. Das ist ungünstig. Und deswegen betreiben wir Skill Discovery. Das heißt, wir fragen uns gegenseitig, okay, was hast du denn letztes Jahr gemacht oder was machst du für Projekte? Und es sind so wahnsinnig viele tolle Sachen, die dabei rauskommen, dass man sich immer wieder denkt, okay, warum seid ihr nicht noch selbstsicherer und kommt mehr raus aus euch und zeigt es einfach. Das ist einfach genial, was da passiert. Ja, oftmals, was in lokalen Chaos Treffs oder mit mehr Treffs, wo eben Männer dominieren, passiert, ist, Frauen fühlen sich als the odd one out. Die gehen dahin und sehen nicht jemanden, der gleich ist und deswegen haben sie halt das Problem, dass sie sich vielleicht nicht so willkommen fühlen und da möchten wir bei helfen. Network, Network, Network. Frauen können sich gegenseitig Jobs zuschustern und sie nörden auch sehr gern ab. Was machen wir auf dem 35C3? Jetzt gerade läuft das Hexenbreakfast. Ihr könnt euch uns, wie schon gesagt, im Assembly Space treffen. Um 2 Uhr findet auf der Chaos West Stage ein Panel statt. Wir haben diverse Workshops. Guckt auf hexen.org mal vorbei. Und morgen ist nochmal eine Happy Hour, auch nochmal in der Chaos West Lounge. Nächstes Jahr machen wir ein Geek End wieder. Dieses Jahr war das erste Mal und hier sind ein paar Sachen, die wir da wahrscheinlich produzieren werden, also Projekte machen, selbstorganisierte Workshops, jeder bringt was mit. Wir planen entsprechend den nächsten Kongress und wie gesagt, heute nochmal den Hinweis auf das Panel, kommt um 2 Uhr vorbei.
Und wir haben dieses Jahr auf dem Kongress auch das große Schreinprojekt. Und zwar haben wir für Remarkable Women, also für wichtige Frauen in den MINT-Berufen, Schreine gebaut, genau gesagt bauen lassen von ganz vielen Assemblies, die uns dabei geholfen haben. Wir haben das organisiert und die könnt ihr überall auf dem 35C3 finden. Und ihr könnt auch immer noch mitmachen, indem ihr euch einfach ein Plakat malt. Ihr könnt auch Kartpapier bei uns bei der Assembly haben. Da ein Plakat für eine Frau, von der ihr gerne berichten möchtet, malt und ihr einfach eure Assembly aufhängt oder wo ihr einen guten Platz findet. Wir helfen euch da gerne.
Das war's, vielen Dank. Dann kommt What Now? Be an Ally.
So we will go back to English now again. My name is Melzai, actually, and since I made the slides most of them, I forgot to add my name on them, which is a very smart thing to do. What now? Now you've heard a lot about feminism and about the Hexen, but this doesn't mean that anything changes for you, right? So first of all, if you define yourself as female somehow, you can join the Hexen. So you can meet up at the Congress, write us an email, or meet us in our local groups. Even though we have around 5 local groups, there are even more Hexen around in the area, around Germany. So mail us and we will find one for you. But most of you do not, even in a slight bit, may identify themselves as female or can label themselves as female. So now you're sitting again in the audience and are watching these talks and also listen to the Me Too movement. You think, what can I do? You can read up. Sadly, you cannot join the Hexen, and we don't have an additional part for you to join in. But instead, you can vote properly for reproductive rights, equal pay, high female representation in the parliament, and high representation of any minority in the parliament, which is very important. So please read the party programs and do a wise choice. The second step you can do is read up. Read about unconscious bias, read up about diversity, read up about creating a positive environment and about cooperation and conflict solving. The good thing about this, actually in the last years the Congress has made increasingly efforts about mediating conflicts. So we have people on site that know how positive environment works and how positive conflict solving works so that in the end everybody is happy with the situation. And there will be a conflict solving workshop, I think, tomorrow afternoon, in example, by the Hexen. And there, I think I've seen other workshops as well. And the good thing is, you don't even help only women. You help every introvert and every person who's trained to keep the opinion to themselves. So you make this environment better for everybody around you if you try it. And the most difficult thing about this diversity movement is probably that you need to try it out. This means you need to make mistakes. And we at the Hexen, we don't think that mistakes are in general a bad thing, even though trying out feminism and being for equal rights is a very difficult task. Still try it out, but please don't repeat the same mistake again. That's the deal, right? Never try it out the second time. Read up, listen, and just try out a different thing. That would be okay. To help you, again, we have given some more resources for you. There are some Women in Tech annual reports where they have asked the women who are working in the US about their problems and about their situations, etc. And you can start reading there. After that, you can go, most probably, if you're a person in power, you can look into mentoring, how and why mentoring women. There's a book out there which is written by 2 American Army profs. It's very short and it's very on the point and it's fully packed of resources. It's not a self-help feel better book, but it's really basically a scientific manual, very short but readable for normal humans. And it has a very weird undertone. If you feel like a marine when you read that book. But after that, you know what you should do and you know where the pitfalls are and you are way more collected about the situation. So, and there's also some more materials about how being an ally, which means you cannot be female because you haven't decided to be female, but you can be an ally to all the minorities. We found one homepage where there's a lot of resources and where the voice and the opinion is very well thought. Maybe there is not every link we agree with, we don't know. You will find more probably something, but this is the point where you start to think and you try it out, you know? And you don't repeat the same mistake again. And after that, you can also read about an example, because this is always helpful. And we have recently seen the Hubble Committee publishing 2 reports about 2014 and 2018. And in 2014, they have tried a lot of things to counter bias in giving Hubble telescope time to also female lead groups. And only in 2018, where they introduced a double-blind review process, they were able to succeed. Anything else didn't work. So maybe this is a suggestion for the future, probably for the Congress. And today, hey, come on. As we say, told you, we have a panel at 2 o'clock. And tomorrow evening, it's the Hexen and Friends party, so you can join in too. And we have a drum and bass set playing there. So have fun. See you around.
Thank you. So the next 5 talks, according to our records, are going to be in German. So you might want to check out c3lingo.org for translations. Next up is Fähre Elektronik. Ah, no need to hurry, we are still good in time.
Hallo. Okay, mein Name ist Verena Kaiser. Ich arbeite für Naga IT, ein Verein, der seit 2009 eine faire Computermaus herstellt. Und mit dem Talk will ich noch mal kurz auf die Branche aufmerksam machen, die all die Dinge, die wir hier so selbstverständlich und so gerne nutzen, um unser Leben besser zu machen und mit denen es so viel Spaß macht, rumzuspielen, zu beleuchten. Okay, für viele wahrscheinlich nichts Neues. Ich umreiße es trotzdem noch mal kurz. In der IT-Branche haben wir es mit vielen Menschenrechtsverletzungen zu tun. Meistens geht es schon dabei los beim Rohstoffabbau, über die Weiterverarbeitung hin zu Bauteilen bis hin zur Endmontage. Werden einfach Menschen ausgebeutet und müssen teilweise unter lebensgefährlichen Bedingungen arbeiten. Tja, und in der IT-Branche, also mit den ganzen Elektrogeräten, ist es leider nicht so wie bei Kaffee oder Kakao, wo wir mittlerweile faire Alternativen haben. Und deshalb hat die Gründerin von Naga IT, Susanne Jordan, 2009 entschieden, endlich mal ein Produkt auf den Markt zu bringen, das so fair es geht hergestellt wurde. Da hat sie sich die Maus ausgesucht und einfach mal eine aufgeschraubt, reingeguckt, festgestellt, ach, eigentlich sind da gar nicht so viele Dinge drin, das wird schon irgendwie möglich sein. Das ist jetzt aber das Bild unserer Lieferkette derzeit. Die gibt es von Anfang an und die wird einfach immer transparent gehalten und stellt eben dar, was alles in unserer Maus drinsteckt. Wir kaufen quasi die Bauteile ein und lassen die dann zusammenmontieren in einer Firma bei einer Firma in Regensburg. Genau. Wir sehen also, dass wir es hier mit sehr vielen Akteuren zu tun haben und jeder Kasten da ist also gleichzeitig ein Arbeitgeber, aber eben auch ein Nadelöhr für uns, weil wir kommen quasi von oben, also wir kaufen Produkte ein und müssen dann bei denen bei uns sind das viele kleine und mittelständische Unternehmen in Deutschland und Europa, die eben noch Bauteile produzieren selber und bei denen fragen wir danach, wo habt ihr eure Sachen her, unter welchen Bedingungen sind die hergestellt, sofern sie es wissen. Das sind also Nadelöhre für uns und wir sind immer darauf angewiesen, dass die Leute die Infos rausgeben und auch selber ein Interesse daran haben, dass die Dinge, die sie einkaufen, fair produziert sind. Unser Einfluss sinkt dabei leider exponentiell, weil wir sind nur ein kleiner Laden von ungefähr 5 bis 7 Mitarbeitern und die kleinen und mittelständischen Unternehmen, mit denen wir zusammenarbeiten, sind viel größer als wir, aber die wiederum sind auch viel, viel kleiner als die Zulieferer, mit denen sie zusammenarbeiten. Tja, und weil das so ist, habe ich hier ein Anliegen. Wir sehen einfach immer noch auf der Landkarte, dass es ganz wenige Initiativen gibt, die versuchen, Elektrogeräte fair herzustellen. Also es gibt das Fairphone, kennen wahrscheinlich alle, Naga IT ist vielleicht auch noch ein Begriff. Dann gibt es noch den fairen Lötdraht von Verlötet und damit hört es aber leider auch schon auf. Weil die anderen viel mehr sind, viel größer und viel mehr Einfluss haben, dachten wir, okay, es wäre eigentlich cool, diese Waage ein bisschen umzudrehen und daran weiterzuarbeiten, dass wir eben wieder mehr Einfluss kriegen. Und deshalb suchen wir, und da finden sich vielleicht welche unter euch, wir brauchen Leute, die Bock haben, auch andere IT-Produkte herzustellen, die so fair wie möglich sind. Leute, die Bock haben, bei uns entweder mitzuhelfen, zum Beispiel werden wir total oft gefragt, so ja, warum macht ihr keine ergonomische Maus oder warum habt ihr keine Gaming-Mäuse so? Ihr könnt ja mal ein Gehäuse entwickeln, wenn ihr Bock habt oder setzt eine faire Tastatur auf oder fragt eben, so wie ihr uns fragt, warum macht ihr keine Gaming-Maus, fragt doch mal die Großen, warum sie eigentlich keine fair produzierte Maus herstellen. Genau, das ist unser Anliegen. Für Leute, die nicht so in der Maker-Szene unterwegs sind, würden wir uns aber auch zum Beispiel auch freuen, wenn es eben durch diesen Nachfrageaspekt, also für diesen Nachfrageaspekt irgendwie Kampagnen aufgesetzt werden. Also, keine Ahnung, irgendeine Postkartenkampagne an alle wichtigen Akteure in der IT-Branche, um eben Aufmerksamkeit auf dieses Thema zu lenken. Genau. Und falls ihr gar keine Zeit habt, ist es einfach wichtig, dieses Thema im Hinterkopf zu behalten. So, es ist cool, diese Produkte zu haben und es sagt auch keiner, dass wir sie nicht nutzen sollen. Aber es ist total wichtig, die Leute im Hinterkopf zu behalten, die daran arbeiten unter lebensgefährlichen Bedingungen, dass wir diese Produkte haben. Danke.
Danke. Dann geht es weiter mit QR-Codes, Offline-QR-Generator.
Ja, hallo. Also, stellt euch mal folgende Situation vor. Ihr seid im Browser, am Desktop oder am Laptop und ihr wollt euch halt irgendeine Seite oder sowas aufs Handy bringen oder zum Beispiel sogar ein Passwort auf das Handy. Und da möchte man ja meinen, dass ein QR-Code ein gutes Übertragungsmittel wäre, ist privat, man scannt direkt ab und eigentlich kein Problem, klingt einfach. Da findet man dann zum Beispiel diesen JavaScript-QR-Code-Generator namens JavaScript-QR-Code und sieht vielversprechend aus, hat JavaScript den Namen, läuft also wahrscheinlich lokal. Es sagt sogar, es ist in purem JavaScript geschrieben, also nochmal stärker. Es sagt, es ist eine Mini-JavaScript-Bibliothek, um die berühmten QR-Codes zu generieren. Und es hat auch ziemlich viele Nutzer, so mit fast 5000 und guten Bewertungen. Okay. Habe ich mir also mal angeschaut, habe den Quellcode heruntergeladen und reingeguckt. Ja, das kam bei raus. Google, hallo! Ja, der QR-Code hat einfach mal an Google gesendet. Das ist jetzt, das Add-on hat halt die JavaScript-Aufgabe, einen QR, einen String an Google zu senden. Das, ja. Und ich möchte nicht sagen, dass das einzige Add-on ist. Nein, es gibt diese Fälle öfters. Hier ist das etwas transparenter gemacht. Hier ist das dann gleich als neuer Tab geöffnet mit chart.google-APIs. Auch recht witzig. Aber ja, so privat möchte man das ja eigentlich nicht. Man sieht es natürlich auch wieder im Quellcode. Logisch. Und deswegen habe ich mir gedacht, ich entwickle mein eigenes Add-on, eigenes Browser-Add-on. Das nennt sich Offline-QR-Code-Generator. Und das generiert es halt, wie der Name schon sagt, offline und privat. Das ist die Seite, die Add-ons-Seite. Und es hat auch ein paar Usability-Features noch hinzugefügt, die ich bei anderen Add-ons nicht gefunden habe. Man kann zum Beispiel direkt mit Rechtsklick machen und im Kontextmenü QR-Code von Link auswählen, da den QR-Code erstellen. Das gleiche auch mit einer Textauswahl. Oder man speichert den QR-Code direkt, das ist auch kein Problem. Es lässt sich zum Beispiel auch Größen verändern, also der QR-Code ist größenveränderlich, dass man den auch in unterschiedlichen Größen abspeichern kann oder einfach größer ziehen kann. Man hat einige Optionen, SVG oder Canvas und ja, einige Optionen, die man da auswählen kann. Und ja, wenn ihr den haben wollt, dann downloadet ihn doch einfach mal. Aktuell nur für Firefox verfügbar unter dem Link. Ich akzeptiere aber natürlich auch gerne Pull-Requests, falls ihr irgendwie andere Browser-Unterstützung hinzufügen wollt. Ich hatte schon mal geguckt, bei Chrome bzw. Chromium ist das manchmal ein bisschen schwer, weil da so ein paar APIs noch nicht so passen für ein paar Features, die ich nutze. Aber ja, ich akzeptiere auf jeden Fall Pull-Requests. Downloadet ihn euch, der ist kleiner als 200 Kilobyte und ziemlich leichtgewichtig. Ihr findet mich auch unter den angegebenen Adressen. Unter den angegebenen Adressen. Und ja, wir haben, oder ich hatte dann zum Beispiel auch noch darauf Wert gelegt, dass die Permissions, also die Berechtigungen, die man ja bei dem Add-ons hat, dass ich da keine sichtbaren erfrage. Also man kann die wirklich ohne zusätzliche Permissions oder so installieren. Das ist bei anderen QR-Code-Generatoren zum Beispiel auch nicht so. Die möchten dann einfach auf alle Tabs zugreifen. Ich greife nur auf den aktiven Tab zu und damit geht das vollkommen ohne Probleme und alle Features sind drin. Dementsprechend ist das kein Problem. Ja, und genau, es ist auch mein erstes größeres Open-Source-Projekt und es sind auch schon einige Contributors schon gekommen, so im Hackathon gab es dann doch einige, die beigetragen haben. Das fand ich auf jeden Fall sehr nett. Also schon mal Dank an euch, falls ihr jetzt irgendwie zuguckt. Und genau. Und weitere Pull-Requests werden gerne akzeptiert und danke für die Aufmerksamkeit.
Danke. So, dann kommt Digitalisierung in der Medizin.
Das wäre das 8.
Bitte?
Das wäre das achte Dia.
Entschuldigung. Ach, danke. Okay. Jetzt sind wir am Anfang.
Okay. Alles klar. Ja, mein Name ist Stefan Streit. Ich bin Arzt. Ich spreche als Berichterstatter aus der Praxis, aus der Arztpraxis. Ärztliche Versorgung findet in einem hochregulierten Raum statt und hier machen die Behörden und Politik die Spielregeln. Das E-Health-Gesetz sagt, liebe Ärzte, schließt euch bitte ans Internet an, damit ihr die Telematikstruktur nutzen könnt. Und die Landesdatenschutzbeauftragte NRW sagt, nein Ärzte, ihr dürft auf keinen Fall eure Praxisrechner mit Patientendaten ans Internet anschließen, weil das verstößt gegen die Spielregeln. Die DSGVO sagt, für jede ärztliche Datenübertragung von einem Arzt zu einem anderen ist eine anlassbezogene Bevollmächtigung erforderlich. Wie es zu so einer Konstellation kommen kann, macht vielleicht hier diese Aussage des Präsidenten des BSI deutlich. Letzten Endes gesteht er damit ein, digitalisierte Daten in einem Netzwerk können technologisch schlicht und ergreifend nicht geschützt werden. Betrachtet man Daten als Sache, findet Digitalisierung in der Medizin in folgendem Kontext statt. Weiße Datennutzung, das ist alles das, wofür wir diese Daten erhoben haben, in der Sprechstunde, die zweckgebunden erhoben wurde, ist illegal, letzten Endes sanktionsbelegt und deutlich erschwert. Graue Datennutzung ist alles das, was per vorgehaltener Einwilligungserklärung abgepresst wurde oder was irgendwann mal ungewollt öffentlich geworden ist, ist unreguliert und auf eine sonderbare Weise legal. Schwarze Datennutzung ist illegal, aber attraktiv und überhaupt nicht reguliert. Digitalisierung in der Medizin sieht gegenwärtig so aus. Ich wollte das immer schon mal auf einer großen Leinwand sehen. Wie kann es gehen? Also, der biopsychosozioinformationelle Gesundheitsbegriff fasst Daten als Teil der Gesundheit auf. Was Krankheit ist, biologische Krankheit, ist irgendwie jedem klar. Psychische Erkrankung wäre Angst, soziale Erkrankung wäre Armut und informationelle Krankheit würde man als eine beschädigte Datenwolke bezeichnen. Dass immer dann, wenn das, was andere über mich wissen, mich beschädigt, dann bin ich informationell erkrankt. Der soziale Gesundheitsbegriff nach Thure von Uexküll ist ein etabliertes, lang geübtes Konzept in der Medizin. Wenn man den ergänzt um die informationelle Unversehrtheit, kommt man eben zu diesem biopsychosozioinformationellen Gesundheitsbegriff, den ich hier zur Diskussion gestellt habe. Das Konzept ist in der Langversion begutachtet worden und steht veröffentlicht auf der Homepage des Instituts für Sozialstrategie. Wenn man diesen Gesundheitsbegriff akzeptiert, dann kommt man ganz schnell dahin, dass Gesundheitsdaten eben auf keinen Fall Sachen sind, sondern Persönlichkeitsanteile. Und Persönlichkeitsanteile, die sind unabteilbar von der Person. Die sind schutzwürdig und die sind unveräußerbar. Das heißt, ein Handel damit ist letzten Endes völlig undenkbar. Und parallel zu diesen ganzen Sachen läuft ja im Moment so eine Organspendediskussion. Da gibt es unglaublich wichtige Parallelen, die da in der Zukunft auch noch zu diskutieren werden. Nimmt man den dritten Aspekt, der aus der DSGVO da hervorgeht, nämlich die Zweckbindung, wird man nie wirklich ernst nehmen, dann dürfen Daten aus der ärztlichen Sprechstunde einfach nur für ärztliche Sprechstunde verwendet werden und für keinen anderen Zweck. Jeder, der diese Daten verwenden möchte, muss zeigen, dass er einen Provenienznachweis hat oder diese Daten neu erheben, dann ist das okay. Wenn man diese drei Dinge in Anschlag bringen würde, dann haben wir eine DSGVO-konforme Situation. Die Telematikinfrastruktur, die ja überall gepredigt wird, um eine digitale Gesundheitsakte voranzutreiben, das war gestern schon Thema, wäre völlig problemlos möglich, was sie jetzt auf keinen Fall ist. Und die DSGVO würde die Menschen tatsächlich vor den Datenkraken schützen. Und wir hätten prompt so eine Situation. Weiße Datennutzung wäre legal, rechtssicher und auch komfortabel möglich. Graue Datennutzung wäre nur noch so äußerst begrenzt denkbar, weil sie hochreguliert wäre und auch Sanktionen möglich wären. Und schwarze Datennutzung wäre zwar weiterhin möglich, aber viel, viel unattraktiver, weil letzten Endes der Markt der grauen Datennutzung ausgetrocknet wäre. Ups. Digitalisierung in der Medizin und in der Arztpraxis geht also genau auf diese drei Punkte zurück. Das ist der derzeit einzig praktikable und bekannte Ansatz, wie man Digitalisierung in der Medizin durchführen kann. Was wir erreichen müssen, ist, dass gelebte Digitalisierung unsere Gesellschaft beflügelt. Dazu müssen wir Kontextfaktoren wie den Gesundheitsbegriff und den Eigentumsbegriff an die digitale Realität anpassen. Wenn wir das erreicht haben, dann erfaltet Digitalisierung nicht nur ihr technologisches, sondern auch ihr soziales Potenzial. Vielen Dank.
Danke.
Thank you very much.
Then next up is, oder als nächster Talk kommt, Medienkompetenz kann man nicht downloaden.
So. Hallo. Mein Name ist Jens Möller. Ich spreche heute darüber, warum man Medienkompetenz nicht downloaden kann. Und hier schließe ich auch Technikkompetenz mit ein. Aber was meine ich eigentlich damit? Huch. Ja, zwei Komponenten. Kompetenz im Umgang. Kann ich Medien und Technik nutzen? Bin ich in der Lage, aus dem Angebot das für mich Passende auszuwählen? Darüber hinaus kritische Auseinandersetzung. Kann ich denn das Angebot selbst in Frage stellen? Und kann ich alternative Möglichkeiten sehen und auch nutzen? Fehlt die kritische Komponente? Bin ich nur Konsumentin? Ich bin entweder mit dem Angebot zufrieden oder ich passe mich an. Merke ich den Unterschied? Die Gestaltung übernehmen andere. Und wir kennen genug Menschen, die gar keinen Bedarf sehen. Die Welt ist eben so. Wichtig ist also eine Aufklärung, die kritische Auseinandersetzung fördert. Doch wie steht's darum? Frischen wir mal unsere Erinnerungen auf. In den 80er und 90er Jahren waren Computer nicht für alle Menschen greifbar. Es gab eine Einstiegsschwelle, man musste sich selbst Kompetenzen aneignen und Zusammenhänge erforschen. Die Botschaft der Aufklärung damals: Spaß am Gerät. Das heißt, kreativer Umgang mit Technik, Grenzen austesten und überwinden. Aber auch gesellschaftliche Implikationen mit und vordenken. Viel Arbeit. Heute ist die Situation ganz anders. Ein riesiger Technikmarkt, quasi keine Einstiegsschwelle für die Nutzung. Jeder Mensch ist betroffen. Die Gestaltung übernehmen Konzerne. Wie erreichen wir die Menschen? Nun, wir senken auch die Schwelle für die Aufklärung. Nach dem Motto, alle können mitmachen und kreativ sein. Ratgeber, die leicht verständlich sind, ansprechend gestaltet und Spielzeuge, Raspberry Pi, Arduino mit endlos viel Zubehör. Statt viel Arbeit haben wir schnelle Ergebnisse. Und damit erreichen wir wirklich viele Menschen, was echt gut ist. Aber die Vereinfachung hat auch einen Preis. Wir erziehen die Menschen dazu, Anleitungen zu befolgen. Es ist ein bisschen wie Malen nach Zahlen. Die Bewusstseinsbildung und die Grenzüberschreitung, die gerät eher in den Hintergrund. Und wir laufen Gefahr, dass wir eben nicht kritisches Bewusstsein fördern, sondern dass aufgeklärtes Handeln eher nachgeahmt wird. Was bedeutet das für uns? Ich sage, Bewusstseinsbildung ist eine soziale Aufgabe, die wir nicht technisch bewältigen können. Wir müssen unseren Bildungsansatz generell in Frage stellen, mit dem Ziel, dass Menschen sich nicht auf das festlegen lassen, was ihnen als KonsumentInnen angeboten wird. Dass sie die Fähigkeit haben und auch die Verantwortung sehen, die Welt mitzugestalten. Ein wirklich hohes Ziel. Doch wir müssen das Rad nicht ganz neu erfinden. Frischen wir noch einmal unsere Erinnerung auf. Vor knapp 50 Jahren hat sich ein Pädagoge aus Südamerika mit genau diesem Thema beschäftigt und Antworten geliefert. Mit der Befreiungspädagogik von Paulo Freire können Menschen erkennen, dass die Wirklichkeit, dass ihre Wirklichkeit für Veränderung zugänglich ist und können so aus der Passivität herauskommen. Es gibt viel zu tun, mehr dazu morgen, denn dazu brauchen wir eure Ideen und Erfahrungen. Wenn ihr schon im Bildungsbereich aktiv seid, Jugend- oder Erwachsenenbildung, oder wenn ihr einfach euch angesprochen fühlt, kommt morgen 17 Uhr ins CCL, Raum 1415. Und da tauschen wir uns aus, wie kritisches Bewusstsein gezielt gefördert werden kann und welche Methoden uns dabei helfen können. Ich freue mich auch über Rückmeldungen per E-Mail oder gleich direkt neben der Bühne. Ja. Danke.
Vielen Dank. So, dann kommt Baut kleine geile Startups auf. Das ist zeitkritisch, deswegen lade ich das erst, sobald alle da sind. Ja, das ist mit den Skates ein bisschen schwierig.
So, überhaupt nicht
schwierig. Ich starte mal. Ne?
Ja, hallo. Also ich bin Peer Aaron de Loon. Meine Freundinnen und Freunde nennen mich Paar de Loon. Aber ich muss immer einen falschen Namen angehen, um Vorträge einzureichen. So, ich probiere mal ein neues Format. Du hast ein Start-up, weil du viel Kohle machen willst oder ein bisschen dabei die Welt verbessern willst und du verhaspelst dich kaum, wenn du versuchst zu erklären, was du da eigentlich machst, weil auch keiner richtige Nachfragen stellt. Du versuchst mit glühenden Augen Keynotes im Familienkreis zu halten. Auf die Nachfrage, wovon du lebst, reagierst du souverän. Bald wird er kommen, der Business Angel. Und dieser Business Angel wird dich nach den Assets fragen, die du zu bieten hast. Du jammerst im Chor mit Regierungsaltmaier, dass den Gründern in Deutschland alles so schwer gemacht wird. Du klabasterst mühsamst Code zusammen, klaust dir hier und da freie Software, die doch letztendlich nur Open Source ist. Schon bald hast du ein Mockup deiner wunderbaren Fu-Up. Ja, der Insta-Button, der funktioniert schon und der Facebook-Login und die Datenbank dahinter, die klappt auch schon ein bisschen irgendwie. Das ist alles richtig cooler Fu. Die Fonts werden übrigens von Google nachgeladen. Übrigens danke dafür den JavaScript-Hinweis. Deine zusammengeswarmte Oberfläche füttert hunderte, wenn nicht gar tausende von Tracking-Seiten. Aber es sieht so cool aus. Und du kannst Mate trinken, dankeschön. Und du hast das verdammte Pech, dass niemand ehrlich zu dir ist, sondern dich ganz lieb bewundert, wenn du ihm deinen Fu zeigst. Denn dein Fu ist eigentlich scheiße. Kein Mensch wird das brauchen und falls du das Pech hast, doch hast du nichts anderes geschaffen als einen weiteren Datendunstsauger, der organisierten digitalen Kriminalität zuarbeitet. Du willst nämlich nur der Kleindealer auf den Dorfstraßen der digitalen Diaspora sein, der für die Mafia Scheiß um Scheiß digitalen Faschismus verkauft. Ich glaube, da stand Schuss um Schuss, aber du bist ein Nichts. Und jedes Mal, wenn dich jemand damit anheizt, dass wir ein deutsches Google brauchen und das bisher noch nicht geschaffen wurde und dir im Hinterkopf dieser dumme Satz dein Großhirn zertrümmert, wirst du kleiner und kleiner und deine einzige Hoffnung ist, eine Lehrerin oder einen Lehrer zu heiraten, um über die Runden zu kommen. Denn es braucht kein deutsches Google. Und man muss es Startups auch nicht einfach machen. Im Gegenteil, macht es euch schwer. Findet heraus, was ihr wirklich könnt. Und vor allen Dingen findet verdammt nochmal heraus, was ihr nicht könnt. Sucht euch Leute, die das können, was ihr nicht könnt. Oder seid der oder diejenige, die jemandem zuarbeitet, der die Führung übernimmt. Seid Alice, um es von eben dem Vortrag aufzunehmen. Stürzt euch in eure Steuererklärung, denn ein Business ist nur dann sinnvoll, wenn ihr Steuern zahlt. Lernt die Regeln, sonst kicken sie euch weg, sobald euer Business zu laufen beginnt. Jammert nicht rum, hört nicht auf das Gejammer von Versagern, namens Dorothee Bär und Altmaier. Und vor allem macht was Vernünftiges. Denkt euch nicht nur einfach irgendein Scheiß aus. Das hält euch davon ab, das Richtige zu tun. Schaut doch mal, was wirklich gebraucht wird. Ich kann hunderte und vielleicht tausende Anwendungen und Dienste aufzählen, die wirklich gebraucht werden. Manchen dahinsiechenden freien Softwareprojekten, also auf Deutsch allen, fehlt nur der richtige Kopf. Schaut euch doch mal auf diesem Kongress um. Schaut doch mal, wo Leute richtig tolle Tools für das gemeinsame Zusammenleben und Arbeiten in einer Gesellschaft konzipieren und an den mangelnden Ressourcen scheitern. Und legt einen Eid ab. Baut mit euren Tools dezentrale Strukturen auf. Unterstützt freie Formate, gebt den Code frei. Pfeift auf die Investoren, die den Schuss nicht gehört haben und Assets sehen wollen. Stürzt euch in sinnvolle Projekte und plant Feierabend und Urlaub mit ein. Vor allem, gebt keine personenbeziehbaren Daten weiter. Wenn ihr nicht selbstgeschriebenen Code verwendet, schnifft eure eigene Software auf seltsame Verbindungen und geht nicht zur Republika, das verdirbt den Charakter. Es sei denn, ihr seid gefestigt in eurem Glauben an das Gute und ihr seid hundertprozentig sicher, dass euer Business niemals ein Big Brother Award bekommen wird. Vielen Dank.
Danke.
All right, danke. Thank you. So this is the end of the first Lightning Talk session. We will see you tomorrow, same place, same time.